Okay, let's welcome Zeus Pender.
Okay, so we're here to talk tonight about fun with securities law. I'm supposed to laugh. More specifically, we're going to talk about real estate syndications. And so probably some of you know this already, but a real estate syndication is just simply where you've got one or more promoters, if you will, syndicators, principals, who put together a real estate investment plan and bring in investors to fund it. So why do you do this? Well, kind of the obvious reasons. You may want to buy properties that you couldn't afford on your own, or you and your close friends wouldn't be able to afford. You may feel that you want to buy a number of properties so you can spread risk. That way, if any one property turns out badly, it doesn't matter so much. So those are some of the reasons for doing this. Where to begin? I could probably talk for about 3 or 4 hours straight, but I will try to simplify this as much as I can. But it's a very complicated area, and I do want to tell you that if you do get involved in this, you want to make sure you have an attorney that you're talking with about it. This is not some areas of law, you can go out and do stuff on your own and you won't get in any trouble. This one's an easy area to get into trouble with. There's a lot of very intricate securities laws that apply. So one thing I want to say to people initially is that most situations where you're bringing in investors are going to be securities. Are going to be what they call securities, governed by the securities laws as a result of that. And this includes things like most promissory notes, most tenants in common arrangements, things that a lot of people will probably hear, they will tell you that they aren't securities. And in fact, they almost always are. There are a few rare exceptions. If you form a member managed limited liability company where every member takes an actual active role in the management, that may well not be a security. But anytime you have passive investors in particular, any passive investor, it's going to be a security, absolutely.
Can you define what a passive investor is, though?
Yeah, somebody not taking any management role. Okay. That has no, they just put in their money, they get their returns back out. They, are not taking any role in management.
Contractual arrangement that's on paper and documented?
Yeah, all of this would be on paper and documented. But the way it usually works, is that it's set up generally in real estate, and we do non-real estate deals also. Startup companies and mid-level companies that are looking to raise money and that sort of thing also that have nothing to do with real estate. What you're normally giving the investors, it's going to be a couple things. The syndicators form an entity, which is usually either a corporation or an LLC. In real estate, it's almost always an LLC. And this has to do with various tax reasons that I'm not going to, I won't worry with it. The IRS says if you've got a real estate entity, and more than a third of its revenues are from rents, then if it's a corporation, it's going to be classified as a C corporation, and that's a disaster tax-wise. So for that reason, almost all of these real estate syndications are LLCs. There are some rare exceptions, but virtually all of them are LLCs. If you're outside the real estate area, you've got more options, frankly. Corporations work just great. But real estate, almost always going to see an LLC. Then what you're doing then for the investors, you can almost structure things any way you want. Any way you can imagine, and it can be written up to do that. Usually in real estate, it is a fixed return on investments. So, they put in so much money and they get a return of 12% a year or something like that, and there's a lot of variations on this. Or they're going to actually own stock or more usually ownership in a limited liability company, which is either in units or percentages. I think it's a little easier to deal with units, but you know, nothing wrong with doing it with percentages. I just think mechanically, for certain things, units are a little easier to deal with. And units in an LLC are like stock in a corporation. There's minor differences, but the non-concern is here. So one of the reasons when you're setting up one of these things to do this is that an entity, I mean, as opposed to just setting it up without an entity, is to protect yourself, the syndicator, and the investors from personal liability. So that's the real reason why it's done this way. I mean, you know, you can do it, and this is about one of the problems that a tenancy in common, or TIC arrangement, runs into, because what it effectively is a general partnership. And what that means is if you have individuals invested in it, they have potential liability for what might go wrong with the investment. So, on the other hand, that can be avoided. It's not necessarily that an investment in a tenancy in common arrangement. When you do that, you want to form your own corporation or LLC first and have it rather than you invest in the tenancy in common arrangement. Okay, so the reasons, we've talked about this already. C corporation is generally to be avoided as an entity because of the two levels of taxation. It's fine as long as you're not profitable, since you probably want to be profitable, it's a concern. And so the deal is, if you've got a C corporation, this would be like, you know, when you think of major corporations, they're all C corporations. C is just an IRS designation, a tax designation. But like, you know, IBM, Coca-Cola, I mean, these are all C corporations. A C corporation pays income tax on whatever income it as a corporation has, and then the owners pay personal income tax on whatever dividends, distributions, salaries, whatever they get. So there's these two levels of taxation. With an LLC, and with something called a subchapter S corporation, it's more or less pass-through. There's no, with some fairly minimal exceptions, there's no taxes on the entity level, even if it's making a profit. The profits and the losses all pass through to the owners directly. So for tax purposes, an LLC or a subchapter S corporation are what you want to be doing in general. But there are, it's law, you know, so anything I tell you tonight, there's always going to be exceptions to it, but I can say this as a general rule anyway. So you can then set this up to get a little finer grain on, you know, what investors can get out of this. The syndicators want to think about structuring the deal to make it attractive for investors, their investors. And so one of the things that is a common theme in this area is a lot of this stuff tends to be driven by who you expect your investors to be. You're going to structure things based on what will seem attractive to investors you believe you're going to have access to. And different people have access to different types of investors, you know, based on their careers and their contacts and, you know, what they're doing. The investor groups can be pretty different. But in any case, you try to figure out in advance who you think, a profile, if you will, of your investors, and then you structure things based around that. So one thing you can do, and sometimes these are just examples. Sometimes these things don't matter so much, and sometimes they matter a lot. But for example, you can set up, well, the backup. The syndicators generally have an ownership interest in the entity, the LLC, and the real estate. And they can either put money, some of their own money in for that, or they can receive their ownership interest in return for their services to the LLC. Sometimes it can be an advantage if the promoters, if you will, the syndicators, can say, we've we've got some of our own personal money in this that sometimes impresses investors. They feel safer with that. But, you know, other times, it doesn't matter.